thank you for coming and giving me this great opportunity to introduce our activity in Japan. And also, I have to thank you for all taking care of my colleague, Junya Tomo. We are very happy to see he is living here and studying well, very well here. Anyway, first of all, I want to say sorry for because I cannot speak any French. And also my English is not so good. So please be patient for my language. But anyway, I will try to introduce our activities. So today my title is Challenges to Save Lives from Sudden Cardiac Death by Subjective Neurological Approach. As Christoph introduced me, I'm working at Kyoto University Health Service. I'm a school doctor and occupational physician and also epidemiologist. My specialty is resuscitation science and also recently tried to develop health promotion, health science. This is a building, very old building. Health service at Kyoto University. And first of all, I want to say that the impact of sudden cardiac death. This figure, you can see the temporal trend in the rhythm of death in Japan. Do you know the first one? I'm sorry. And second one is a heart disease. I would say, as you know, there are many cancers. For example, lung cancer, the breast cancer, the colon cancer. So as a single organ, as you know, the heart disease is the leading cause of death, and also it is increasing year by year. And very importantly, most of deaths due to cardiac disease occur out of hospital settings. In this video, you can see about two-thirds of deaths due to acute coronary syndrome occur out of hospital settings. So we have to more focus on out of hospital settings, not only in hospital treatments, to decrease sudden cardiac deaths. All of these data is from Europe. And next, I want to introduce briefly registry of out of hospital cardiac arrest. And today I want to say OHCA. This is out of hospital cardiac arrest. And I also introduce outline of OHCA in Japan based on this registry. Firstly, very fortunately, for out of hospital cardiac arrest, we have a consensus guideline to report resuscitation calls for out of hospital cardiac arrest. We call the Doudstein style guideline because this guideline is defined at Doudstein Shrine in Norway. So this is an international guideline for uniform reporting of data from OHCA. And based on this uniform reporting form, we have conducted Doudstein Osaka project. This is a population-based registry of OHCA covering about 9 million residents in Osaka Prefecture since 1998. And firstly, I want to introduce this Osaka and Kyoto. Have you ever been to Japan? Thank you. Do you know Osaka? Oh, yes, and Kyoto. I think Kyoto is one of the most popular cities in the world. And anyway, Osaka is the second largest city. Recently, maybe south, but in a very big, large city, and basically business city. We have unique cultures in Osaka, like this. And Kyoto is a very historical city. And importantly, we have many universities, including ours, Kyoto University. In Kyoto cities, we have over 30 universities. Anyway, Osaka and Kyoto is west part of Japan, very near. It's only 30 minutes by train. But the culture is very different. And we do not like each other. that's it. Anyway, today I want to introduce resuscitation science data from Osaka area, because Osaka is the leading area of emergency medicine in Japan. Now we try to promote, try to make Kyoto as a health promotion agency. Anyway, following the Utsutai Osaka project, very fortunately, all Japan Utsutai registry was started since 2005. This is a national project, and I think this is one of the largest Utsutai style databases in the world. We cover all cardiac arrest in Japan. By use of this registry, we can describe the outline of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest in Japan. For example, here you can see the number of out-of-hospital cardiac arrests due to cardiac cause. The number is increasing year by year, and the latest data shows over 70,000 out-of-hospital cardiac arrests of cardiac origin occur. And also we can demonstrate the improvements of emergency medical system and improvements of survival from sudden cardiac arrest. In this figure, you can see the temporal improvement in emergency medical service system. Do you know the time course is the most important thing to improve survival from cardiac arrest? So here, for example, you can see the time from collapse, sudden cardiac arrest, to the call by bystander, by rescuers. In 1998, it was median 4 minutes from collapse to call 119. But the time is shortening year by year, and the latest data shows 2 minutes median. And most importantly, this shows the time from collapse to delivering shocks by EMS personnel. This shows in 1998, the median time from collapse to shock was 90 minutes. But then we tried to brush up, improve the EMS system, and the time from collapse to shock is shortening and decreasing year by year. And the latest data show, it's not 2006, it was median 9 minutes. But still, it's very dramatically improving. And as a result, you can see the temporal improvement in survival from out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. This data is from Osaka area. Red blue line shows the 1 month survival from sudden cardiac arrest, sudden out-of-hospital cardiac arrest. And red line shows the neurologically intact survival from sudden cardiac arrest in Osaka. Witness cardiac arrest or cardiac origin. This is adult data. Anyway, about the past 10 years, we observed very dramatic improvements in survival. Like this, for example, neuroendocrine survival increased from 2% to around 9%. And 1 month survival improved from 5% to 15% during these years. And importantly, recently, the improvement curve is not good. It's almost stable. And as I said, now we have a national database for sudden cardiac arrest. So we can see the nationwide improvements in survival from OHCA. In the left figure, you can see neural intact survival from witnessed out of hospital cardiac arrest. This data is from 2005 to 2009. During these 5 years, the neural intact survival from witness cardiac arrest improved from 2% to 4%. And on the right figure, you can see neural intact survival from witness VF cardiac arrest. You know VF, shockable reason. We can deliver in shock. And in this case, the survival, we have a better survival time. In this case, it's return improved from 10% to 20%. Anyway, during these 5 years, we get about double the survival. It's a very basic data, but we think this is a very important improvement, nationwide improvement. So this very basic data is published in Circulation. And it is also very important. Now we have more data. So in this figure, you can see the temporal trend in survival from 2005 to 2014, the latest one from national data. Here you can see the improvement during the first 5 years. But then the survival is almost stable. You can see. So now we are thinking about there should be some barrier. We need next steps to break through the survival. And there should be some strategy to save more lives from sudden cardiac death. First things should be a preventive approach. Prevention of cardiac arrest itself is more important. But we know there should be some cardiac arrest. It cannot be prevented. In these cases, we have to spread CPR or AED. So education and implementation to increase survival after cardiac arrest is also important. Firstly, I want to introduce very briefly about preventive approach. This data is also from our team, from Osaka area. Here you can see the association of cardiac arrest with fluid activity and temperature. Red line shows out-of-hospital cardiac arrest during bathing. And different from other activities like sleeping, exercising, or working, there is a very typical trend. So during January or December, in the cold season, winter, the incidence of cardiac arrest during bathing is increasing. 11 times more compared with summer. But cardiac arrest during sleeping or exercising or walking is on step. So by use of these data, we can educate or enhance the importance of prevention during very basic. Because, for example, in Japan, usually the bus, the atmosphere of bus that is not good. So usually we were very cold, and then taking bus, very cold, and then very cold. So these changes should be one of the reasons of introducing cardiac arrest. So this preventive approach is also important. But anyway, we think we know that preventive cardiac arrest is very limited. So once we had cardiac arrest victims, we have to save lives from cardiac arrest by CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation, or AED. So let's move on to next steps to spread CPR or AED. Do you know AED? AED. No. Automated external defibrillator. Don't you know? DAD in France.
DAD. Maybe few people will know, you know, so it's interesting to see that, and maybe you should give some explanation.
Okay. So in Japan, since 2004, it has been legal for any person to use AD and deliver shocks by use of AD. We have many AEDs in Japan, right? For example, all direct train, Shinkansen train has AEDs. And in some areas, police car has AEDs. And for example, in Tokyo University, we have a vending machine with AEDs. And in this vending machine, you can buy AEDs. Just kidding. for HA. And here you can see the cumulative sales number of public access AEDs. That means AEDs located in public places except hospitals, or medical institutions, or fire departments. The number is increasing. For example, 2005, it's about 10,000, and then increasing. And in 2013, it's over 400,000. And the latest data showed the number is over 600,000. Over. Anyway, now we have many AEDs in Japan. And in this video, you can see the neural intact survivor after witness VF cardiac arrest. These are latest girls use AEDs and data shocks by use of AEDs. The neural intact survivor can be about double. And the neural intact survivor is around 40%. So this data means if we had cardiac arrest out of all hospital settings, still the neural intact survivor is 40%. And if there was no AED and the victims gave shocks by emergency medical personnel, ambulance, the survivor is less than 20%. So now we know that AED has a very strong power to save lives. And in summary, we have many data that CPR, cardiopulmonary resuscitation can increase and double the survival, and also delivering shock by use of AED can double the survival. And this figure shows the temporal trends in the proportion of public access AED among witness VF of cardiac origin. So in 2013, 17% of out of hospital VF patients can receive shocks by use of AED. And the proportion is increasing year by year. And this data is from Osaka area. We can know the more detailed data. In this data, I want to say the most appropriate situation, location for AED is in Japan, is a rail station or sports facility. For example, in the sports facilities, about 60% of sudden cardiac arrest victims already can receive shocks by use of AED. So the AED, public access AED system is very well developed in some selected situations, like sports facilities or stations. In this paper, we show that CPR and AED use during exercise. In the left figure, you can see the temporal trends of the bystander CPR provided by lay rescuers. The proportion is increasing year by year, and the latest data show in sports facilities or sports settings, over 80% of cardiac arrest victims can receive bystander CPR by lay rescuers, including sports instructors. And here you can see the temporal trend in the proportion of delivering shocks by AED in sports settings. And the proportion is also increasing, and the latest data shows over 60% of sudden cardiac arrest during exercising, can receive the shocks by AEDs. And as a result, the survival is also dramatically improving. Here you can see the favorable neurological outcome from sudden cardiac arrest during exercising. The latest data shows the neural impact survival is around 60%. It's a role model, very successful results. But I want to say this is a very limited situation. It's less than 1% of total sudden cardiac arrest. Sudden cardiac arrest during exercise is very small. So we have to spread these steps in the application in many topics. And I would say we have many such experiences like this. She was elementary school student, fifth grade elementary school student. She had some cardiac arrest during exercise in school, in front of many teachers and students. And now in Japan, almost all schools have AD, including para school. But very unfortunately, no teacher couldn't recognize she had subcardiac arrest, and the AD was not used. So we have to educate and improve the implementation to let them use ADs more and more. And we are thinking that the key factor to save more lives by use of spreading ADs should be dissemination of CPR, simplified CPR, and implementation of ADs, I think. This figure shows the proportion of bystander CPR. The proportion of bystander CPR is increasing. And this data is from Osaka area. The proportion is less than 20% in 1998. But recently, we tried to spread CPR education, and dispatch system can teach them how to perform CPR. By these efforts, the proportion is increasing, but still around less than 50%. That means about 2/3 of cardiac arrest, or at least half of cardiac arrest victims cannot receive any CPR before EMS arrival, ambulance arrival. So we think a chest compression with CPR can increase the CPR and save more lives. Basically, I want to say CPR should be more simplified because emergency settings is usually very confusing and it's very difficult to provide CPR in this confusing situation. So we think simplification of CPR is very important. And we have many data about the effectiveness of type of CPR. Type of CPR means traditional CPR consists of rescue breathing, mouth-to-mouth ventilation, and chest compression. So yeah, there are many, many data about the effectiveness of type of CPR. That means conventional CPR, including rescue breathing, and chest compression CPR. This is our very important data from Osaka area. We show that chest compression with CPR by bystander can increase the survival compared with non-CPR. The adjusted growth ratio of chest compression with CPR for neuro intact survivor is 1.7. And very importantly, the adjusted growth ratio is almost the same with conventional CPR with rescue breathing. It's 1.6. There are many, many data from this type of registries that show the effectiveness of compression with CPR. This is SOS Kanto study. It's also a registry of OHCA in Japan, east part of Japan. And this data shows compression with CPR might be better than conventional CPR in some settings. But on the other hand, there are some other concerns about there might be some population in among them. The conventional CPR with rescue breathing might be better than compression in CPR. The most typical situation is cardiac arrest of children, pediatric cardiac arrest. Because in the right side, you can see the survival from cardiac arrest of non-cardiac origin of children. About 70% of cardiac arrest of children is due to not cardiology, but rescue breathing problem or something. In these cases, our data also shows that conventional CPR with rescue breathing might be better than compression CPR. So it's very confusing. In children, cardiac arrest of non-cardiac origin, rescue breathing might be beneficial. But this data is a survival from adult cardiac arrest for those the AED delivery shocks. So in these cases, the duration of CPR is very short. In these cases, compression CPR might be better than conventional CPR for rescue breathing. So there are many discussions in the resuscitation group. But I want to say that the effectiveness of compression only versus conventional CPR might be case by case. I believe for most cardiac arrest cases, compression only may be enough. But most important thing is that any CPR is better than no CPR. And the proportion of CPR either compression only or conventional is still less than 50%, at least in Japan. So we have to increase any type of CPR. Okay. This is our consensus. And based on this consensus, JRC means Japanese Resuscitation Council CPR guideline was changed since 2010. Conventional CPR training is traditionally 3 hours training, including rescue breathing. But from 2010, we started to introduce compression only plus AED training, very short one. And the purpose is to increase brave rescuers who can perform at least chest compression and use an AED on the scene. And also, we developed to train compression with CPR because most important things of compression only is it's very easier to teach, learn, and perform. So we made a training kit like this. After my presentation, please try this training kit. So if we chose chest compression with CPR, it's very simple. So it's very easy to train. But we think it's important to let the attendee experience how hard to push. If we push correctly, we can make noise like this. So we developed this type of training. And also, we made a video. And in this video, this dog teach how to perform chest compression. His name is Ojore. He's from this area. And also, we call push training. This is a simplified chest compression only and AED training. It's very simple, so we can train many people at once. For example, in this mass training, we trained over 3,000 people at once in the baseball field. They some don't work, but like this. This is the situation. We train many people at once. And as a result, so Japan tried to spread CPR by use of chest compression only. And here you can see temporal trends and temporal increment of bystander CPR. This light gray shows compression with CPR. And dark gray shows conventional CPR with rescue breathing. And importantly, totally, the proportion of bystander CPR is increasing dramatically. And latest data shows around 50%. And in model area in Osaka, we try to aggressively spread CPR values of chest compression only, and try to evaluate the impact. In this area, we targeted this Toyonaka City, is a middle-sized city in Osaka area. And in this area, we targeted the breakthrough point around 16%. Because there is a theory of diffusion of innovation, and that suggests there should be some breakthrough point to spread some things, like smartphone or something. So in this area, we try to reach 16% of the region. And this slide shows the temporal, this slide shows the CPR training in Japan. In Japan, traditionally, fire departments train citizens how to perform CPR basically. And this figure shows the number of trained by fire departments. And it is the average is 2.5% of population per year. This is the baseline of CPR training in Japan. And in this area, we try to train about 16% of the population. And this is the result of this area. This light gray shows the conventional CPR training. That means 3 hour CPR training, including rescue breathing. But it's very difficult to train many people. So we add compression-only CPR training, right, as I shown. And totally, we trained over 23% of the population during the last 6 years. And we evaluated the change in the proportion of bystander CPR. This is the main result. We have more data, but today I only showed the data from 2010 to 2013. But unfortunately, the proportion of bystander CPR is almost stable. There was no change yet. But in this area, prospectively, we are collecting quality data, quality of bystander CPR. And this black line shows the good quality of bystander CPR. The proportion of good quality CPR is increasing, fortunately. But anyway, the proportion of bystander CPR itself is almost stable. So now, we are trying to submit this data, but these data suggest that increased bystander CPR or change the citizen attitude of CPR might be more difficult than buying something. So we think continuous sustainable CPR dissemination should be needed. And our result, our opinion is that school CPR is a key to spread, disseminate CPR in the community. So now we are focusing on the CPR education in schools. As I said, this type of simplified CPR is easier to introduce to schools. This is a CPR class in junior high school, and right side is a CPR class in elementary school. And also, we are making some support materials for school teachers, especially for elementary school, because for elementary school, there is no duty to train CPR yet. And also, in our universities, we started to train all of newcomers every year. Kyoto University has 3,000 students every year. So we are conducting CPR training for all of these 3,000 new students. And already we trained over 10,000 students at Kyoto University. So I hope all the universities follow this project. And this project is very important because not only train how to perform chess compression on ADU, but also this can be a chance of communication. So this is very important and chance for students to communicate each other. Anyway, this wider dissemination of CPR or ADU intervention is important. And next, I want to introduce our new approach to increase CPR on the scene, or provide AD on the scene, right? We named AD Go. Do you know Pokemon Go? When we started this project, Pokemon Go was very popular. 2 years ago. Recently, I'm not sure AD Go is acceptable or not. Anyway, as I shown, the number of AEDs increasing year by year in Japan. We have many AEDs, but here you can see that the proportion of AED shocks, delivering shocks, among witness arrest of cardiac origin is still less than 5%. So we have many AEDs in community, but it doesn't work well, not well. But as I shown, once we provide shocks by AED, the survival can be increased dramatically. So the next step should be increase the proportion of those who receive shocks by AED. It's our next challenge. And one of the characteristics of sudden cardiac arrest is that the connection is different. We have many AEDs, and we have many people who want to provide CPR or who want to provide AED shocks, but usually we do not recognize sudden cardiac arrest. So we think smartphone application or these social media can connect sudden cardiac arrest victims and those who want to save lives or AED. And we already have a very good, very nice study from Europe. This is a paper in the New England Journal in 2015 in Sweden. And they showed the effectiveness of social media technologies for EMS system. And once introduced this system, the proportion of bystander CPR significantly increased compared with the systems without this smartphone application. So we try to introduce this type of system in Japan, social network service. So once cardiac arrest took up, usually in Japan, in most of cases, the registered found some cardiac arrest, then they call 119 in Japan. And dispatch center is think there might be suspected cardiac arrest. They send the information to the smartphone and registered volunteer registers can recognize cardiac arrest location and location of themselves and also nearby AD. And then bring AD to the scene. And we are conducting pilot study in Odessa City in Aichi Prefecture since 2015, because in this area, the Odessa city is very aggressive to set AEDs. For example, all of the convenience stores in this area have AEDs. The city provided AEDs. So totally 142 AEDs in this area. And this figure is this is a simulation. As I said, in this area, we already have many AEDs, but if the AED and covered only 150 meters. It is a traditional coverage. If so, only 10% of past 5 years' categories can be covered by this APIs. But if we introduce this smartphone application system or something, and covered area from each AD increased, for example, from 150 to 300, then if the number of AD itself is the same, the proportion of the coverage rate is over 60% of past 5 years' categories. And if each AD covers 600 meters area, for example, by use of drone or by use of bicycle or something, then almost 100 of past 5 years' categories can be covered by AD. So we think the total management of some categories is as a committee, a committee level is important. And now we are conducting pilot study in this area, and then we will try to spread this system to whole Japan. Anyway, in the latest CPR guideline, we reinforcing the importance of CQI process. CQI means continuous quality improvement. And we say no measurement, no improvement. I think all of you think the same things. And PDCA cycle, or plan to, we call PDSA cycle, plan to study act cycle, is very important. So our study epidemiology is not a study, not only study, but also implementation or project to improve something. And this is the news from the United States, very famous news, showing the difference in survival by region. There was a very dramatic difference of survival from Southern Caress. Anyway, I think the visualization is a key to improve systems. So epidemiology is one of the parts of visualization. And we have a very good role model. For example, research station science, for me, the Seattle City is a role model. They are conducting this type of project since 1980. They spread, they improved the EMS system, and they are collecting many good data and showing the effectiveness of improvement of EMS system. So I think epidemiology can save lives from some characters like this. And again, merci to give me this great opportunity. If you have questions, please give me. This is final.